हेलो गाइस, दिस इज अदिप। वेलकम टू माय चैनल मूवमेंट साइंस, वेयर आई सिंप्लीफाई बायोमैकेनिक्स एंड आल्सो लॉट ऑफ ऑर्थो टॉपिक्स विद जो। सो इफ यू आर न्यू टू दिस चैनल, कंसीडर सब्सक्राइबिंग। आल्सो चेक मी आउट ऑन इंस्टाग्राम, वेयर आई पोस्ट डेली एमसीक्यूज एंड आल्सो पिक्चर्स ऑफ माय नोट्स। द रेफरेंस टाइम फॉर ऑल द टॉपिक्स दैट आई एम गोइंग टू कवर विल बी मेंशन डाउन इन द डिस्क्रिप्शन, सो चेक दैट आउट एंड लेट्स गेट स्टार्टेड। Welcome to the first video of your hip joint complex. In this video, I will give you a brief introduction to hip joint and we will talk about the proximal articulation of the hip joint. Then we will also cover the labrum and the angles that are formed in the proximal articulation. So let's start with the topic. So for a brief introduction, the hip joint is also called as the coxofemoral joint. It is a ball and socket type of joint and it carries out functions like flexion extension, abduction, adduction, and medial and lateral rotation. It is very similar to a shoulder joint in the upper extremity. We will talk about the movements in depth in our kinematics part. So we'll go ahead and let's look at the function. Hip joint supports your head, your trunk, and your arms. It also provides a good mobility to your lower limb. And also with that, it helps you carry out different functions like running, walking, and jumping, right? So I think that's enough for the introduction. Let's start with the topic, that is the proximal articulation. Now the proximal articulation is your acetabulum, right? So this is your acetabulum, which is formed by your three bones, your ilium, your ischium, and your pubis. So if you look at the bone, this is your ilium, this is your ischium, and this part is your pubis, right? So if you look at the ilium and ischium, they make 2/5 of your acetabulum and the 1/5 is made by your pubis, right? And these three bones, they ossify at a very late age, that is around 20 to 25 years. So this is an important point which can come for a MCQ, okay? So then going ahead is your lunate surface and your acetabular fossa. So this acetabulum can be divided into your lunate surface, which is there outside, and your acetabular fossa. So if you look here, this is your lunate surface and the fossa over here, right? So the lunate surface is also said to have a horseshoe shape. So let's look at some of the features of your lunate surface. So your lunate surface has an acetabular notch. So if this is your lunate surface, this is the notch that you can see. So if this is your lunate surface, this is the acetabular notch, and here is the transverse ligament which is present. So this is your acetabular notch and then there is the transverse ligament which is there. Why have I written it in red color? Because it allows blood vessels to pass through it. So you can remember it that way. And it also, this acetabular notch which is there over here, it has a lining of hyaline cartilage, right? And I always write cartilage in blue. So the color coding really helps. Then going to the next part is your acetabular fossa. So we learned about the lunate. Now talking about the fossa, it does not have any cartilage. This is a very important point, that there is no cartilage. Instead of that, what we have is there is a fibroelastic fat layer which is present in your fossa, and there is synovial membrane which produces synovial fluid in your acetabulum and lubricates your hip joint. So that was about the structure. Now let's look at the labrum. Now talking about the labrum is fibrocartilaginous in structure. It does not have a load distribution function. That is a very important point, because we often think that labrum is increasing the surface area, so the load distribution will be better because of labrum. But that is not the case over here, because it was seen that even when the labrum was removed, it did not affect its load distribution much. Then the next point is the nerve ending. Your labrum has a lot of nerve endings in it. So if there is any damage to your labrum, it is painful. That is something you can keep in mind, that if patient complains of pain in the hip joint, labrum should come into your mind, because it can produce pain because of the injury. Okay. Then going to the next point is the proprioception. It also provides proprioception to the hip joint. It is basically ability of your body to know where your joint is positioned in space, right? So basically, if I'm keeping my eyes closed and if I'm taking my hand behind my back, I still know that my hand is behind my back. Why? Because of the proprioception. So this concept I've also talked about in the knee joint videos too. Okay, so you can go check that out. So that is your proprioception. Then going to the next point is the hydrostatic pressure. It builds up a very high hydrostatic pressure. We'll look at this properly. So if you take the labrum, which is there around your acetabulum, and then your femur is going like this, right? So if you can see, the labrum nicely seals it over here. And that is basically what we are talking about. The synovial fluid, which is there inside, it helps in better lubrication of your hip joint because of the high hydrostatic pressure. And then the last part is the anterior superior part of the labrum is most commonly injured during flexion. So if you see, this is the anterior part and then the superior part. So this area of the labrum is most commonly injured, and mostly it happens during flexion. And most of the time the labrum gets injured due to the impingement, and that is the source of your pain. And oftentimes it is the leading or the starting point for your degenerative diseases in the hip joint. Now that we have covered labrum, let's talk about the angles. Now we are going to talk about two angles. There is the acetabular antiversion and then there is the central edge angle. Now acetabular antiversion, what it tells is basically how much your acetabulum is facing anteriorly. It tells the magnitude of anterior orientation of your acetabulum. Okay, so to understand that, let's look at the pelvis first. So this is your pelvis, right? This is how it is facing anteriorly and slightly laterally. Now I'll keep the half part aside, and if you see how much the degree, the magnitude of the anterior orientation of your acetabulum is basically your acetabular antiversion. The more it is anteriorly oriented, that is increase in the pathological angle of your acetabulum, it reduces its stability, reduces the stability of hip joint, and also increases the chances of anterior dislocation. Let's see how. So if you take your femur, it's nicely moving over here, right? Now I will increase the acetabular antiversion, right? So this is your acetabular antiversion, which is increased, and now there is more higher chances of your femur dislocating anteriorly, right? This angle is often measured through CT scans and different imaging techniques, so it's quite complex. Then going to the next angle, that is your central edge angle, which is also known as angle of Weberg. This is a very important MCQ again, where they can ask you the other name for your central edge angle, right? This angle tells you basically your inferior orientation of your acetabulum, okay? So it is basically the angle that is formed by two lines. The first line is the line connecting lateral end of acetabulum, and second is the line passing through the center of the femoral head, the vertical line passing. Let's look at this. So if you see the first line I was talking about, the line connecting the lateral end of the acetabulum. So this is the one end of acetabulum and this is the another end. So this is the first line. Basically your acetabulum is like this, right? The concave thing. It is basically the line that is touching both the lateral ends of the acetabulum. So this is the first line. And the second line is the line passing through the head or the center of the head of the femur. So that is the second line. So that angle is your 35 degree, which is seen in females, and 38 degree is seen in males. So it's clear, right? The central edge angle, it is the line, it is the angle that is formed by these two lines. And another last point that I wanted to add is, it was seen that this angle increases with age, and it is seen that as your age increases, your hip becomes more stable. So therefore there is less stability in kids because they have a lesser central edge angle. So that is something you can keep in mind, that kids have a smaller central edge angle, and these are the normal values that also you can keep in mind. Okay, so now let's summarize the topic. We talked about the acetabulum. It had two parts, the lunate surface, which was outside, and then the acetabular fossa. It was made up of three bones, that is ischium, ilium and pubis, right, which ossifies at age of 20 to 25 years. Then we talked about the labrum, which is there around like this and has proprioceptive function. It also has a lot of nerve endings, so it is painful if there is any impingement and damage to your labrum. Then we talked about two angles, the central edge angle, which tells you how much your acetabulum is oriented inferiorly. And then the second one was your acetabular antiversion, which was telling you how much your acetabulum is oriented anteriorly, right? So those were the two angles we studied. With that, we finish up this topic. That's all for today, guys. Thank you for watching. If you like my content, please share it with your friends. And don't forget to hit that like button and some comments so that I can get some feedback regarding what other topics I can make. Also, don't forget to hit that subscribe button, and see you soon in the next video.